mountain, you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down.
Welcome to Gardenside, guys. Wow, it is a beautiful, beautiful day outside. The sun's coming through the stained glass windows and looks gorgeous. Why don't you guys stand up and let's sing together. You can sing this with us.
What would the King of all want with this broken heart? Why would he take the fall, knowing us as we are? Glory beyond the shame, healing beneath the scars. Nothing remained the same. Now that we've seen your love, great is your love. Nothing is greater than your love, great is your love. Nothing is greater than your love. No matter where I will find your grace. Mercy has made us one, never to separate. Power beyond the grave, freedom beneath the cross. Nothing remains the same now that we've seen your love.
Understand me, God. You understand me. So
And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
As we were singing that last song there, it's kind of got me startled a little bit because of my communion meditation here, but I'll continue on. And John says in John 19:30, Jesus' last words were, "It is finished." That's the English translation for a word, tetelestai. That's a Greek word, tetelestai. In a business context, the word tetelestai was put on a receipt for a debt paid in full. In a judicial context, tetelestai was said to mean that a sentence was fully served. In a military context, tetelestai meant that the battle had been won. So when, what's that mean to us? When Jesus was on the cross and he said, it is finished, your debt of sin has been fully paid, the judgment for your sin has been fully served, and the spiritual war against death, sin, and Satan has been won. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you now for this opportunity to come and remember Jesus. Remember his great sacrifice, Lord. I just pray that you open our hearts to that. In your name we pray. Amen.
Father in heaven, we're thankful for this another Lord's Day to be in your house and to worship you. We ask now that as these tithes and offerings are offered, that you'll bless both the gifts and the givers. Guide us and lead us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
I will lift my song up.
fight my battles, and I believe. I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Sing it again. It may look like I'm surrounded by you. Like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battle. This is how.
Father God, thank you for promising us all the protection we ever need in our deepest doubt and our deepest fear. Lord, you protect us and you save us and you guide us. Deliverance from that fear. We love you, Lord, and it's your Son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
All God's people said. Good morning. Welcome to Gardenside. My name's Greg, in case we haven't met. I know I met a couple people. It's your first time here, and man, we are so honored that you're here today. For those watching online, welcome to you. In fact, I met a guy earlier this morning that shared with me that he had been watching online in Louisville, and he's here today for the first time. And so, who knows? Maybe we'll start a satellite campus in Louisville someday, right? Hey, Bible says you have not because you ask not, right? So dream big or go home. And after all, Pope is here, right? So I want to give credit where credit's due. Stone Donaldson came up with that. Pope is here. I like that. So instead of hope is here, Pope is here. But hey, we kicked off a new series last week, and we're calling that Find Your Purpose. Find Your Purpose. I think we all want to know, do we have a purpose? And friends, I got great news this morning. We do. We all have a purpose. As my hero, Wally Rendell, says, if you've still got a pulse, you've still got a purpose. And so we've been looking at that. We're basing this off a movie called Ordinary Angels. And this movie was in the theaters in late February. It's based on a true story in Kentucky, actually, up in the Louisville, Kentucky area. And it's based off a precious young mom that dies, unfortunately. And the dad's, you know, he's in grief. Then he finds out one of his young daughters has to have a liver transplant. So he's already dealing with all these medical debts. And then he finds out that he's got another daughter that he could possibly lose. And man, he needs an angel. And this lady named Sharon Stevens just jumps in and says, hey, you know what? I feel led to help. And she just does some amazing things. And the cool thing is next week, Sharon Stevens, who the movie is based on Ordinary Angels, she's going to be here at Gardenside next week. So, yeah, there's a picture of her. And one of the big things out of this movie is organ donations. So next week's going to be Bring a Friend Day. All right, we're going to have a good potluck, and trust me, the people in this church, they can cook. We're going to provide the chicken. We're going to provide the drinks inside your handout, and man, I want to really challenge you to make sure that you get one of these every week, okay? We can't go through all the announcements. God is just doing a lot of things here on the back and inside, and so I hope that you'll intentionally get one each week, but next week is Bring a Friend Day, and we've got a little nice little handout. Some of you are like, I don't know how to do that. Just hand them this. Say, hey, be my guest. And I'm going to interview Sharon Stevens to just share how God used a normal person just like you and just like me to be an ordinary angel. Then the following week, we're going to talk about purpose in prayer. Purpose in prayer. On Thursday, May 2nd, is National Day of Prayer. And I don't know about you, but I think our country used a little prayer. Amen? And I want God to know we're serious about it here at Gardenside. We have somebody every Sunday that is back in the prayer room that is praying for you, for God to speak to you right where you need to hear his voice. But you know what? We want to take it to a whole nother level. And we're going to pray for 24 hours. And I'm asking for 48 people to commit to 30 minutes. And I'm so thankful that a lot of people in our Bible study on Wednesday night, down here in the conference room, hope you'll come join us sometime, that we've got 20 people showed up. We still need 28 people. I signed up for 2 a.m. because sometimes I have to get up middle of the night and go do something, you know what I mean? And so I'm just going to stay up. I'm going to pray for 30 minutes for this church. I know some of you are like, well, man, what do I pray about for 30 minutes? Well, we've got a pamphlet for you. So I hope when you leave today that you'll stop in the lobby and get that, and you'll sign up, and we can pray for our country, we can pray for our city, for our church, and pray for each other, and that's kind of where we're heading. Well, in Ordinary Angels, this dad, Ed, he's just overwhelmed with losing his wife. He's grieving a young wife, and then he's got this daughter that's sick. He's got all these debts, financial burdens, and he's starting to doubt his faith a little bit. And last week, we talked about purpose in the pain, but there's also purpose in our doubt, friends. The moments when we wonder if God is even there. And maybe that's where you're at today. And if that's where you're at, man, we are so glad that you're here. Because we want to talk about purpose in the doubt. You know, maybe you can recall a time when your faith was really strong. I mean, you were just like, you know, man, I can withstand anything. But then life just started kind of chipping away at you, and all of a sudden Satan starts whispering in your ear, and you start to doubt and question about your faith. And I love it. You know, sometimes spiritual truths that have become black and white, now they become gray. You say, well, why do I love that? Because, friends, that's when our faith becomes real. It's easy when it's sunny and 75 today, okay? Right? UK's got a new coach. He's undefeated, baby! You know, all right? Yeah, right now, man, he's awesome because he's undefeated, you know. And then when he loses the first game, why'd we hire him, okay? But the fact of the matter is, friends, it's when it's cold and it's overcast and there's more money, I mean, more bills left at the end of the month and you got money, right? When the health report's not good and when you're lonely, that's when our faith, we start to lose it and becomes doubtful. But, friends, that's what makes it real. And I love that we can talk about this here. And there's a guy in the Bible that, man, there's no doubt God had his hand on him. Maybe you're familiar with his name was John the Baptist. And he's a guy that actually even had some doubt too. You're like, John the Baptist? Yeah, I mean, think about this. I mean, he was the one that was foretold in the Old Testament of the Bible. People say, oh, I just like reading the New Testament. Friends, you need to read the Old Testament too. It was foretold that somebody was going to come and predict that Jesus was going to come and the Messiah was going to come and just make all things new. And I mean, and then on top of that, he's going to baptize Jesus. I mean, you're talking about a big responsibility introducing Jesus, the Son of God? You think you got pressure at your job? I mean, right? But you know, a little side note, you may not remember this. John the Baptist was actually Jesus' cousin. He was about 6 months older than him. John the Baptist, he preached a baptism of repentance, but he spoke of the one who was coming, and he said, you know what, I'm not even worthy to tie his sandals. It says it this way in John chapter 1, verse 29, if you will. Let's read this out loud together. We should have it up on the screens. Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We got a little bonus there for you. John then went on to baptize him, and a dove came down from heaven. Okay? It came down from heaven, and it said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Friends, I love that. Jesus hadn't done anything yet, but he did what the Father asked him to do, and that was to be baptized. He hadn't healed anybody. He hadn't performed his first miracle. And I know that some of you were here for Easter, and you saw that we had two baptisms. We had a precious little girl, Olivia, and then we had an adult, Lori Love, that got baptized. And I thought, that's a beautiful picture, how God pursues us as a child and even as an adult. I'm sharing with you, my dad didn't accept Christ to almost 50. Some of you are praying for somebody right now. I want to encourage you, don't give up, even though you doubt they're ever going to surrender their life to Jesus. Friends, we may give up on God, but God never gives up on us. Amen? And some of you are like, when you saw those two baptisms, you're like, you know what? Man, I need to do that. And just, I've been praying at the beginning of the year. I said, you know, I set goals. I kid about the Bible says you have not because you ask not. I prayed and I was like, you know, God, I'm asking for 24 baptisms here at Gardenside because I want to see 24 more people in heaven. And I think that should be the minimum. Right now, we only got three. And I'm ready to do some dunking, baby, okay? I'm ready to do some dunking. Dunkin' Donuts, Dunkin' Greg, okay? So if you want to talk, I'd love to talk to you about being baptized, okay? I had somebody ask me this morning. I'm so thankful they asked me this. This is a safe place. They said, you know, I don't know if I can take communion here because I haven't officially joined the church yet. And I love that they asked that question. I said, and she told me that she had accepted Jesus. She had been baptized as a child. And I said, absolutely. That's what we want to have here, friends, where you can ask questions. There's no such things as dumb questions. And if you've got doubts about anything here, please let me know or one of our elders. Ann's out at the reception desk, the Welcome Center. Man, we'd love to answer those questions. So John the Baptist baptizes Jesus, and so people started just flocking to Jesus. In John chapter 3, if you got your Bible, we're going to be hanging out in John some. John chapter 3, verses 31, 35, and 6, it says, the one who comes from above is above all. The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them. Friends, that's a hard truth to hear sometimes. But friends, we need to know that Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So John the Baptist, he certainly understands that the role that he is to play and the identity that Jesus is the Son of God. But you know, sometimes when circumstances change in our lives, sometimes uncertainty just kind of gradually begins to start creeping in. And the devil starts putting darts of doubt, disillusion in our discerning of who Jesus is. That's what happened in this case. John the Baptist, he had been preaching to crowds of followers. And he finally, humbly, he started turning them towards Jesus. In fact, they asked in John chapter 3, verse 30, this is not in your notes, okay? But John chapter 3, verse 30, they asked him, say, hey, who do we follow now? You were kind of the guy, but now Jesus is on the scene, and who do we follow? And I love what John said. He said, Jesus must increase and I must decrease. And for some of you today, friends, maybe that's where you're at. You're like, you know what? If I'm honest, Jesus must increase and I must decrease. But the world tells us it's all about us. I mean, Burger King's favorite slogan, you know, marketing campaign, have it your way, right? And yet Jesus says, hey, I want to come in and settle in your heart, and I must increase, and you must decrease. But here's the deal. John's preaching style is a lot different than Jesus. I mean, John didn't hold back, okay? Today, we would say that he wasn't politically correct. I mean, he wouldn't compromise regardless of who the preacher might offend. And unfortunately, he really offended a man that was in power, a guy named Herod. Let me share a little background about Herod. Herod had taken his own brother's wife and took her to be his own. And he had gotten rid of his own wife. But John the Baptist didn't shy away from this, and he called Herod to repentance and called him out about it. As a result of that public embarrassment, Herod threw John in prison. And now all of a sudden, things are starting to change. And friends, when circumstances change, when our surroundings, they just start to kind of head south, when your listening crowds are reduced to just from a big mass of people just to the criminal who's chained next to you, you start to get some doubts, don't you? I mean, yeah, I'm not talking about just John the Baptist situation. Some of you know, you're not incarcerated, you wouldn't be here. But you know what? Some of you are incarcerated in your mind and your heart. And life's curveballs, it can cause us to doubt our faith and have questions. So John's been in prison for several months. His influence, obviously, has gone down to basically one person. His self-esteem's got to be down, right? And nobody did anything to help him. All the Jewish leaders that, were with him now, they're not interceding for him. And it also seemed like Jesus was not doing anything for him. You ever felt like that before? Like, where are you, Jesus? Feel like your prayers are going to voicemail or just going to the ceiling, not getting past the ceiling? Perhaps maybe John was frustrated that Jesus hadn't gotten politically involved. Maybe he was kind of like, Jesus, you talked about bringing a new revolution and a kingdom. And John's probably thinking, well, hello, when is this going to happen, Jesus? When is this kingdom going to start? And the Bible tells us that John begins to doubt who Jesus is. Friends, circumstances and time, they can cause us to doubt as well. Perhaps while John the Baptist was in a prison cell, he began thinking of some of the prophecies that he had heard about the coming Messiah. And he believed those. Maybe he started thinking about Isaiah chapter 35, verses 5 and 6. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened, and the ears of the deaf will be unstopped. Then the lame will leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout for joy. These are all things that the Messiah is going to do. Or maybe he thought of Isaiah chapter 42, verses 6 and 7. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles. The Messiah is going to open the eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who are sitting in the darkness. So John's probably sitting there in a prison cell thinking, okay, if he came to set the captives free, man, I got to be a candidate. Set me free, Jesus. Well, that's not how it played out for him. Jesus kept on teaching, and the crowds were growing. And while John the Baptist is hearing all these reports about these things, I mean, everyone is just buzzing about Jesus and all the miracles he's performing, yet it's crickets in his prison cell. You ever felt like that before? Like your prayers are just crickets, nothing from God, where are you? Hello, God, are you listening? I want to ask you today, what is it for you? Maybe you doubt because of the adversity that you've experienced. Maybe it's the loss of a job. Maybe it's the loss of a spouse. Maybe it's tension with friends or with family. In time, the chaos of life, friends, can just cause confusion of our spiritual understanding. Is there a loving God who cares about me? And if so, why did this happen to me? John the Baptist, he starts to hear more stories about his cousin, talking about maybe a little family jealousy, right? And the longer he sits there in prison, he begins to question who Jesus is. And Satan, no doubt, is filling his mind with faulty logic, saying, well, if he's the Messiah, if he was really the Son of God, John, why doesn't he free you? Why doesn't he establish his kingdom, overthrow Herod, and take over? And from a worldly mindset, friends, those are great questions. They're fair questions. But those things start to play on John's mind just like they do in our minds. In Luke 7, John the Baptist attempts to get answers. The only way that he knows how, he asks some of his followers who have visited him in prison to relay a question to Jesus. Let's take a look at that. Luke chapter 7, verses 18 through 20. John's disciples told him about all these things. Calling two of them, he sent them to the Lord to ask, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else?" When the men came to Jesus, they said, "John the Baptist sent us to ask you, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else?" In other words, hey, Jesus, are you the Messiah? Goes on to say in 21 and 23 of Luke 7, "At that very time, Jesus cured many who had diseases, sicknesses, and evil spirits, and gave sight to many who were blind. So he replied to the messengers, 'Go back and report to John what you have seen and you have heard. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on account of me.'" Friends, I think there's a lot going on in this text. John's looking for something that Jesus is not willing to give. If you've had preschoolers, have you ever had that moment when your preschooler comes to you and a little while for dinner and they say, "Hey, can I have a snack? How about a piece of that chocolate cake right there?" And you say, "Oh, no, 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 no. We're about ready to eat dinner soon, but here's some carrots that you can munch on." Yeah, that's how we would all respond. You know, like, "Oh, thanks, carrots, wonderful." But you know what? We don't give the toddler or the preschooler what they want, right? We give them what they need at the time. And so Jesus is doing something very similar here to John. John, because of his doubt, because of his circumstances, he wants something. He wants an answer to this question: are you the Messiah? But Jesus meets the need, but it's not how Jesus might have wanted him to. Anybody ever had that? God answers your prayer, but hey, that's not how I saw this playing out. It's not the way I wanted this to work out. Well, I think Jesus is going to encourage John in three different ways. First, Jesus offers transformation, but not information. Okay? Jesus offers transformation, but not information. John asked Jesus if he's the Messiah. It's a fair question, especially considering the fact that John has already announced that he's the Messiah. So John wants to double check. So he asked, you know, "Hey, I want to make sure I cross every T, I dot every I." And some of you can relate to that, because we do that with God too, don't we? I mean, that's how God messed us up. God, our intellect sometimes is limited for us to get our arms around why God does things the way he does. But friends, I've come to learn that's why he's God and I'm not, right? That's why he's God and I'm not. I mean, do you think Mark Pope thought a month ago that he was going to be the head basketball coach at UK? Does Dick Vitale say, "Are you serious?" I mean, but friends, one phone call, one text can change everything, right? It really, truly can. But when questioned, Jesus doesn't give John more information. But we want more information, don't we? Instead, Jesus gives an object lesson of people in the moment being healed and transformed, which can lead John to the correct answer. Let's look at the second thing that Jesus offers John during his doubts and his questions. Jesus encourages faith more than answers. Jesus encourages faith more than answers. Jesus definitely implies his answer to John's question, but he doesn't explicitly answer it. He even leaves room for uncertainty. Why would Jesus do that? Well, because he realizes that John's doubts can actually lead to deeper faith. There is a purpose, friends, in the season of doubt. Remember what Jesus said in James chapter 1, verses 2 and 3? Let's read this one out loud together, okay? "Consider pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance." Now, friends, I got to be honest. I'm feeling sorry for John at this moment, aren't you? I mean, he simply wanted some answers, but instead, he received a faith challenge. Jesus tells him to examine the evidence and to decide for himself. Ultimately, Jesus was not leading a revolution that was going to force everyone to submit to his kingship. Jesus offered transformation and told people to have faith. You know, one of my favorite Bible verses is Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. It's not in your outline, but somebody listening today, either here in person or online, I believe, needs to hear this. Hebrews 11, 6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Friends, that starts with faith, one, accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or having faith when things aren't going well and life seems unfair. And this really is. The Bible tells us we walk by faith and not by sight, right? And friends, this side of heaven, there's a lot of things I don't understand. But that's why we point to the cross. And this is how I fight my battles. I love that Jesus paid it all. We've left the cross up here intentionally. We have this beautiful one behind us, okay, that I come out often during the week out here and sit and look at that and realize that's my source of strength. But I want to remind you the price that Jesus paid for you, friends, that's still true today, even 2 weeks after Easter. That's where your strength comes in. When you're hurting, you're going through pain, Jesus says, I understand. I know what it's like to be insulted verbally, to be chastised, to made fun of, and to go through excruciating pain. I understand. So sometimes it's not about having an answer to every question. It's about having faith when there is no easy answer. Gary Black, just a great pastor. I was in a tough, tough season of life several years ago, and I met with him. I was just really discouraged. I even had some doubts, okay? And he said, Greg, do you have enough faith? This was like a coffee meeting about 9 a.m. He said, have you got enough faith to make it to noon? I said, yeah, I got that, Gary. He said, okay, all right. Then he said, could you have enough faith to get to 5 p.m.? Yeah, Gary, I can do that. He said, could you have enough faith to make it till you go to bed tomorrow, tonight, and then wake up tomorrow? I said, yeah. Friends, we don't know what the future holds, but I'm so thankful we know who holds the future, amen? And that's what we have to stand on, and not our feelings, but our doubts can overcome that. So John didn't pretend to believe something that he did. And oftentimes, friends, we kind of get into our own doubts. And it's amazing how God will speak through different people. And there's this powerful scene in Ordinary Angels in the movie. It's a place where the dad, Ed, who's now a young widower, seems overwhelmed with his younger daughter's fading health and his inability to pay all these mounting medical bills. So I want us to watch a scene now from the movie Ordinary Angels where Ed and his oldest daughter, Ashley, are visiting the gravesite of Ed's wife. His faith is barely hanging on by a thread, but Ashley is going to do some gentle spiritual prodding. So if you will, turn your attention to the screens, please.
You mad at God, Dad? Is that why we don't pray anymore? It's okay. Everybody gets mad sometimes. You should still talk to him, though.
You first.
Hi, God. It's Ashley and Dad. We miss you. I'm worried about Michelle.
A couple of announcements before we start. Please remember to, if you purchase the poinsettia, please take it with you at the close of the service. We're going to start with one of my favorites, Angels We Have Heard on High, which you can find on the insert in your program. Good to have you back, Ed. All right, sing with me, won't you?
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly sing high, hearts we love.
Help us with our faith, don't we? We have our doubts, and I'm so thankful that Jesus told us we should have the faith of a little child, and Jesus loved children to come to him. Some of you this morning, you find yourself in a really difficult situation right now, but you came to church anyway, or you showed up and tuned in online, even though you're really doubting God. Man, I'm so thankful that you did that. Thank you for putting yourself in a situation here today where you can be encouraged by God's word and by God's people. I'm so glad you're here, and that, you know, man, even if you've got lots of doubts, I'm glad that you're here looking for answers. And my prayer this week, as I've been putting this together, is that God would just speak to you right where you need to hear his voice, whether through a song we sing, through a scripture we share, maybe through a handshake of somebody saying hello. And, you know, if you've never had any doubts, friends, then your faith may not be much of a faith. A faith that's never been tested cannot be trusted. We'll say that again. A faith that has never been tested cannot be trusted. You know, a big oak tree didn't get that way overnight. I love this quote by Rick Warren. He says, God makes a mushroom, it only takes 6 hours. To make an oak tree, it takes 60 years. And friends, sometimes when I have doubts, I have to go back to those times where I know that God has worked. And I have to go back and dig into his word. That's why I give you those inserts inside your handout that shares probably 70% what I'm going to be sharing. And there's lots of scripture in there. If you don't have a daily quiet time, man, I'm encouraging you, okay? There's a place on the back you can take notes where if something speaks to you. But friends, God wants to speak to you. He wants to help remove your doubts. But we have to spend time with the author. Some of you say, well, you know, what is the Bible? I love how Billy Graham described it. He said the Bible is God's love letter to us from Genesis to Revelation. God's love letter to you and to me, telling us how much that he loves us. All throughout the Bible, we're encouraged to study. Look at John chapter 20, verse 31. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing him, you may have life in his name. I want to remind you again, friends, the tomb was empty and Jesus is alive. Amen? In fact, sometimes I think God's just begging us to read his word. Paul encourages us to listen to biblical teaching and preaching in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Let's read this one out loud together. Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Jesus Christ. So our prayer needs to be maybe for some of us today simply, Lord, help me with my unbelief. That's the thing I love about being a follower of Jesus. We can keep it real, friends. God wants a relationship, not a relationship. And just say, you know, right now, man, I'm just doubting. I'm doubting, God. I truly am. Well, here's the third thing that I think that Jesus offered John when he was incarcerated. Jesus offers an eternal perspective over a temporary remedy. Jesus offers an eternal perspective over a temporary remedy. Let me unpack that a little bit. I mean, I like quick answers to difficult questions, don't we? Anybody besides me guilty of in college? Sometimes you got the cliff notes. You had a test coming up. Huh? Don't judge me, okay? But this was before the internet online, right? They had those things called cliff notes, and they took your money and laughed when you bought one, okay? But you know what? It's kind of like that even in TV today. Somebody will go do an interview. I've been interviewed before on TV for different things throughout the years, and it's amazing. They'll use a 30-second soundbite out of a 30-minute interview. Sometimes you'll see quotes on something online and social media, and you think, man, why did they say that? But they don't show the whole context of the conversation. You don't get the whole story, as Paul Harvey said, that's the rest of the story, right? But that's the world we live in. So put yourself in John's place, okay? One of your closest friends, Jesus and John are friends, and he's in prison, and he's questioning your identity. And the one that Jesus gives the best he could have given, because he knows when you're doubting, you need so much more than a soundbite, don't we? Let's look back again at the text. The John the Baptist followers say to Jesus, John wants to know, are you the one to come or are we to expect someone else? So Jesus is asked a question. You would think he would give an answer, but he doesn't. Let's look again at Luke chapter 7, verse 21. At that very time, Jesus cured many who had diseases, sicknesses, and evil spirits, and gave sight to many who were blind. But Matthew and Luke write about this account, but Matthew's account of it is more streamlined and it's summarized. But it appears in a more detailed version in Luke's gospel because Luke was a physician. So he was very detailed. So when Jesus asked the question, "Are you the Messiah?" instead of giving him a soundbite, he gives John's friends an object lesson. It's kind of like this. It's almost like they ask the question, and Jesus looks at them like, "Hold that thought." He doesn't answer. He turns and he starts healing people, and that's his answer. People who are deaf can hear. People who are lame can walk. And then he comes back to them very lovingly and matter-of-factly, and he begins to quote some of the prophets of Isaiah about the coming Messiah. And he says the lame are walking, the deaf are hearing, the blind are seeing. And Jesus goes through all these different statements made in Isaiah about him. But he leaves one out, friends. And I think he does it intentionally. Do you know what he leaves out? It's what I shared with you earlier from Isaiah 42. When quoting from the Old Testament, Jesus omits the phrase, "The captives, the prisoners, are being set free." Why do you think Jesus did that? I think it's because he's sending John a clear message. I am the Messiah. My deeds prove it. But John, I've got some bad news. I'm not going to free you from prison. And friends, there's been times in my life where Jesus, whatever situation, not confined to a cell, but just a painful situation in my life where God's like, "I'm sorry, you're just going to have to endure that. But know that you're not alone. I'm with you." In fact, Paul talks about, and this is not in your notes, but I believe somebody needs to hear it this morning. Paul talked about he asked God, he prayed to remove this thorn in his flesh. In fact, it says he asked God not once, not twice, but three times. It even says he pleaded with God. But God didn't do it. And what? How did God respond? He said, "My strength is made perfect in your weakness." And friends, I think if we're honest this morning, when things are going pretty well, we kind of put it on cruise control and we just say, "God," you know, we develop an ego. You know what ego is, right? Edging God out. "You know, I got this 10 and 2 on the cruise control. I got this, God. Thank you. I'll be back next Sunday. I'm good." And then all of a sudden, we get a phone call, and it changes everything. Or your boss calls you and says, "Hey, I'm sorry, your position's being eliminated." Or your spouse says, "Hey, we need to talk, and I don't love you anymore." Then all of a sudden, we realize, okay, I got to decide whether I'm just a Sunday morning person, and I believe that then, or am I going to get real? And, you know, we give the old sports analogy, you know, do you play for the name on the back, which is your name, or the name on the front of the jersey? And, friends, some of us call ourselves Christians, okay, follower of Jesus Christ, but if we're honest, most of the time, we play for our name on the back of the jersey. And what have you done lately for me, God? And friends, I get it, man. I'm guilty of it. So please, I'm casting no stones judging anybody. And this wasn't in my notes, but I felt like I needed to say it. And for some of us, we got to decide if we're all in. You know, it was funny when Mark Pope was announced as the coach on, I guess, was it Thursday night? I don't even sure what night it was. Oh, my gosh. Literally, it felt like you were saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." You're like, "Mitch Barnhart needs to be fired," and just... I'm taking all this out of context. Give me a little grace, okay? But it's amazing after the next morning, then all of a sudden, "Well, you know what? That'd probably be a pretty good hire. You know what? Man, I like that we hired a former player." I mean, it was just amazing, the difference in 24 hours. But seriously, for some of us, we have to decide, are we all in? And maybe if you're tired of fighting your battles this morning, you're like, "Okay, this hadn't really played out, God, the way I saw life playing out, but I'm going to play the best I can with the cards that I've been dealt and do it for your glory." Amen? And so, I mean, I think there's two types of doubts, friend. We all walk through valleys, and there's two types of doubters. There's dishonest doubters, and there's honest doubters. Okay? Dishonest doubters and honest doubters. dishonest doubters don't want to believe. I heard someone say an atheist can't find God for the same reason that a criminal can't find a police officer. That's funny. You know why? They're not looking for him, right? They're not looking for him. And most atheists and agnostics, they're not searching for God. The Lord says in Jeremiah 29, verse 13, let's read this one out loud together. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I love it. It didn't say with some of your heart, most of your heart, all of your heart. But the truth of the matter is many people don't find God because they do that. If they do, it means they'll have to change their life. They'll have to change their life. And friends, I'm okay with that. A lot of my friends don't call me to do things that, you know, when I was in college and having, just doing things. And you know what? I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. Does it mean I'm lonely sometimes? Absolutely it does. It does. Okay? But you know what? I want to live my life to an audience of one. And hear those words, job well done, my good and faithful servant, someday. And friends, I got to say this in love to you as your pastor. One day the Bible tells us we'll stand before God and we'll give account for everything that we've said and everything that we do. And I don't say that to, okay, once again, just, you know, wow. But sometimes we have to speak what the Bible says, truth and love, right? And I got to ask you, is there areas of your life that aren't God-honoring? Not talking about being perfect, okay? But there's something that you do, something you're watching online, somewhere you're spending your money, something you're doing that's not God-honoring. And Jesus said, hey, I came to help you. I know you got doubts, but I want to help you. Okay? And that's just, you know, that's dishonest doubt. You know, you're not even trying to find it. But honest doubt, okay? Honest doubt is when we're trying to be and act in integrity. God loves honest seekers. When you say, you know what, man, I got my doubts. I'm trying to honor you, but I don't feel like you're hearing me or you're not with me on this. God loves honest seekers, friends. And there are times when all of us struggle with doubt at times. Henry Drummond said, Christ always distinguished between doubt and unbelief. Doubt is, I can't believe. Unbelief is, I won't believe. And Satan is the father of lies, friends. He'll try to get you off center any way he can. And the Bible gives Christians a warning and encouragement to those faith whose faith is solid and strong. And here's what that encouragement of faith for you today is. Jude chapter 1, verse 22, be merciful to those who doubt. Be merciful to those who doubt. But you know what? Friends, we can't swim in that pool of doubt forever. Sometimes we got to take some steps. In Ordinary Angels, Ed, the dad, continues to try and take baby steps. Even though he was in a season of doubt, he tried to be, just to remain open what the hand of God might do and the will of God, hoping at some point he would experience some kind of breakthrough in his life. All the while, this ordinary woman who found her purpose in serving Ed's family continued working hard at lowering Ed's expenses and medical bills. I want to show one more video clip. We're almost done here. And I think this is one of the most powerful scenes in this movie. Take a look at the screens, please.
And you're asking us to reduce the family's medical bills due to hardship.
No, I'm asking you to erase them. All of them. Was that funny? Let me show you something. Ed's daughter made this for school. A family tree. A simple drawing made by a child. How one life leads to another, or in this case, how one death leads to another.
Miss Stevens, please.
Teresa Schmidt came to this hospital for help. Now, the good doctors did their best to save her, but they couldn't, and she died, leaving behind a heartbroken husband and a very ill little girl, Michelle. Her treatment costs thousands of dollars a month her family can't afford. Know why? Because after you sent her mama to the morgue, you sent them a bill so high their family couldn't pay it off in 100 years. You realize the message you're sending this girl, right? You're saying we charged your mama so much to die that you gotta die too.
We can't just eliminate hundreds of thousands of dollars in medical bills. Now, I'm sorry. I truly am.
Virginia, what if it was your daughter? Forgive me, but I did a little homework and I know you got a beautiful 11-year-old girl. What if it was her I was here trying to save? You'd want to find a way, right? For her to have a future. to build branches of her own. Please. Gotta be something we can do here. Open it. Thought you might want to frame this. It's the latest hospital bill. $400,000 wiped clean. Everything from Teresa's hospital stay to all the out-of-pocket expenses, all of it gone.
But how?
I told you I wasn't good at taking no for an answer. Well, look, we still have a lot of medications and the credit cards to pay off, but this means
that... Keep the house.
You get to keep the house. And I don't want to overreact here, but I think this moment warrants a high five.
Excuse me.
Friends, God used an ordinary person like Sharon Stevens, who's going to be here next week, to help this dad, a widow, get over almost $500,000 worth of debts paid. And friends, Jesus has done the same thing for us. He has paid a debt that you couldn't pay, that I couldn't pay. And each week, we give you a chance to say, you know what? I want to make you not just the Lord of life, I want to make you my Savior. And friends, here's what I'm learning. We can't save ourselves. Anybody tried to do that? It's exhausting, man. It is exhausting. But Jesus came and paid a price. He paid all the debts, all the sin, all the bad things we've done, all the bad words we said, all the bad thoughts we've had, all that I have done and said, past, present, and future. And the great thing I love is he gives each of us a choice. God can treat us like robots, but he doesn't. He gives you a choice. And so in just a moment, I'm getting ready to pray. And if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, man, I want you to make today the day of salvation. The day of salvation. He wants to set you free. But you have the key, but you have to open the door. Please open the door. Unlock your heart to Jesus today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you send ordinary angels like Sharon. And Father, we all have our doubts. I do. And yet, Father, I'm thankful that you still love me in my doubts. But the one thing that is so helpful and hopeful is knowing that Jesus is with me. And Father, I know that there's somebody in this room today that, you know what, they've been kind of coming and they check off the God box each week. But you're calling to say, you know what? I want you to draw close to me. I want you to come just as you are, with your doubts, your questions, your disappointments, even your anger, and just come and surrender your one and only life to me. And whatever overwhelming situation you're dealing with, whether it's financial medical bills like Ed was dealing with, or whether it's with rejection from a failed marriage, or whether it's you need a job and... or maybe it's just a challenging health report, a challenging health situation. God, I'm thankful that we don't have to go through those alone and that Jesus promised he would never leave us or forsake us. So God, thank you that you made a way when there was no way. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, friends, each week we give you a chance to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And we're getting ready to sing a song, Come Just As You Are. And man, it's the perfect song for this invitation. It says, I just pray, come with your doubts, your disappointments, even your anger. Maybe you just, life's been so hard. But just come today and say, I'm going to surrender all that to Jesus. I'll be down front waiting for you. Or maybe some of you are like, you know what? I want to join this family. I want to be a part of this team and do life together. Or maybe you just need prayer. Man, your doubts, you're struggling. I just need some prayer. Ken Henderson is going to be coming up front. Ruthie's going to come up front. So we would love to pray for you and help you if you're in a season of doubt. That's okay to have doubts. Just don't do it alone. So if you've got a decision to make, I'll be down front. If you'll stand with me as we sing this powerful song, Come Just As You Are.
Come just as you are.
Still down front. If you would like to be prayed for, we'd love to pray for you. Just quick announcements. Next Sunday after church in our conference room, I'm sorry, in two weeks, we are going to have our VBS planning meeting. If you want to help serve our Vacation Bible School, we just do it 4 nights, Monday through Thursday. Last year, we were blessed with 50 kids, and we're expecting this more. And man, we don't ask your ability, we just need your availability. So if you'd be willing to help in 2 weeks, I hope you'll come to a short meeting down in the conference room on the 28th. Next week, Bring a Friend Day. Who are you inviting? I want to challenge you, invite at least one person. Man, I'm believing God for 250 people. If you would be willing to bring a side dish or a dessert, if you'll sign up in the back. And last but not least, National Day of Prayer. We need 28 more people to join the other 20 already signed up to pray. And so if you'll stop in the lobby and do that. For our first-time guests, thanks for being here. We're honored to have you. We have a special gift for you at the Welcome Center. Man, I hope you'll come back next week. I'll be standing in the back. I'd love to say hello to you. Thank you for being here. I know that God loves you. And Clay will close us out in prayer today.
Holy Father, we know we have doubts, Lord, and we know that you can overcome those doubts with just
just a moment when we call on you. You surround us with your love and your hope and your forgiveness. Lord, thank you for this place that we call Gardenside. Thank you for the light that it is. And Lord, I pray next week that you will continue to show through Sharon and her testimony. Lord, bless our time today, and thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Later, love you, bye. Have a great week, guys.